Good afternoon everyone. So I welcome you all to this webinar, that is be safe on cyberspace. So today we are going to discuss few more topics. So we are discussing these topics from the end user point of view. So we will not be discussing topics in technical depth. So the goal of this webinar is to provide guidelines so that you can use them and you can apply them in your day-to-day life and be safe on the cyberspace. So the next thing which we are going to discuss today is securing your PC. So all of you will be having desktop or a laptop or even a mobile phone. So you have to secure your devices also. So the first important thing in securing your PC will be updating the operating system. Always enable updates for operating system. If you enable updates for operating system and if you have set a notifications on, whenever the company or the OS creators release the updates for the OS, you will get the notification so that you can start updating the operating system. So if you have installed Windows or Macintosh, you will get the notification saying that so and so update has been released by Microsoft and you can install it. Then similarly, if you are working on open source operating systems like Ubuntu or Red Hat or Fedora or whatever operating system, in that case also you will get the notification as soon as you boot the operating system. So you can continue installing those updates. So these updates usually consists of many times security patches, known problems, known issues, which can be possible points of entry to hackers to enter into your system. So those things are generally addressed in these updates. The next is install an antivirus product and keep up to date. Note here that just installing antivirus product is not sufficient, you also need to update it. So you also need to check update notifications for your antivirus product. So even antivirus companies, they keep on releasing updates and updates to their antivirus software periodically. So you need to check whether they have released patch for new virus definitions and you need to install it so that you can keep your antivirus up to date and which will in turn secure your PC. The next is enable computer firewall. So in firewall, what you are going to do is you are going to set some rules. So as per the rules, your system will behave. Say for example, you may choose to block certain traffic from the internet. You may choose to block certain types of files from opening. So say for example, if you download exe file, then it may issue an warning saying that exe file has been downloaded, do you want to install it? Or even your antivirus software will scan for any malicious content in the exe file. So if there are any malicious content, then you can choose to install it or not to install it. The next is use strong passwords. So we have already discussed in the yesterday session regarding the use of strong passwords. So I will not repeat it again. The next is online banking. Now India is promoting Digital India concept. So that means Indian government wants all citizens to use digital platforms for all transactions. So in this case, it also becomes very important for us to follow some guidelines with respect to online banking and online transactions so that we can be safe and our hard-earned money can be safe. Now, few guidelines related to online banking are: never click web links in your email and no bank will ask you to update the accounts through online. So even if you want to update anything, you have to download the official mobile apps or through internet banking website on your laptop and log in there and update the details there. But no representative, no bank will ask you to enter the details. So never click on the link which comes through email. Then never provide personal information including your passwords, credit card information, account numbers to unknown persons. So generally it happens that senior citizens or those who are not technologically savvy, when they visit ATM, they may not be knowing how to withdraw money from the ATMs. Actually, it's very dangerous there, because senior citizens or people, they're asking other people to withdraw money for them, and in that process they are sharing the information. Actually, it is a bit riskier. Never keep username, account name and passwords at one place. Always try to remember the passwords. Okay, so as I have already told you in previous session, you need to choose strong passwords. It should be combination of letters, uppercase letters, lowercase letters, special symbols and etc. And never store your information, your account details at one place. That's because even maybe by mistake, spyware may be installed on your machine, and through spyware, attackers can get all this information. Now, always use phishing filters at your internet browsers. So use appropriate internet browser extensions which can filter the content. So it will clearly tell whether the content is a phishing content. So in phishing, what happens is hackers create similar looking websites and they look similar to original websites, and people will fall prey to those fake websites thinking that it's a original website, and they share all their data and they will lose their money. Then do not click any images in the websites if you are unsure. Then confirm whether email is received from bank or not. Okay, so generally you should see, is it from a legitimate bank and legitimate bank branch. Okay, if you see the senders, you will get some information. And if you are still unsure, then you can also go to header of the email, copy it and put it in some header analyzers, so that you can determine whether the email has come from fake source or genuine source. The next is, be cautious while providing bank details via online. So before proceeding further, confirm with bank about the email you received. Think that if something is important or urgent, why don't bank calling me instead of sending email? Then delete all cookies and history file before you perform online transactions. This is also very, very important. So you should delete all the cookies, history of the web browser, and try to use the fresh web browser for performing online transactions. And once you perform, again delete the history and cookies of your browsers. The next, always use virtual keyboard while accessing the online banking. That is because key loggers may be installed on your machines without your notice. So in that case, if you start typing using your keyboard, those keys will be recorded by the spyware, and it will send that information to the hackers. In virtual keyboard, what happens is you will see the keyboard on screen and you have to press the appropriate characters or letters using just the mouse, and once you press a particular key, again all these keys are jumbled. So it is very difficult to know the exact location of the key. But if you use the physical keyboard, then based on your activities, hackers or keylogger programs can easily detect what you are typing. So always use virtual keyboard. Then delete all the history and cookies once you are done with online transactions. Avoid accessing online banking in cyber cafes. This is very, very important, because you don't know what is the configuration of that system, what kind of softwares are installed. There is a possibility that those systems are already installed with keyloggers and spywares, etc. So never access online banking in cyber cafes. Then next important thing is copyrights. So copyrights fall under the umbrella of intellectual property. So under intellectual property, there are few more things like patents, trademarks, and geographical indications. So with respect to copyright, copyright is an intellectual property that gives the author of an original work exclusive right for a certain time period in relative to that work, so including its publication, distribution, etc. So copyright is described under the umbrella term intellectual property along with the rights and trade name. Or copyright refers to laws that authorize the use of work of a creator such as author, artist, and many more. This includes copying, distributing, altering, and literary and other kind of work. So unless stated in a contract, the author or a creator of any work holds the copyright. So what happens in copyright is the moment you create any art or the moment you create any software, copyright is assigned to you. Copyrights are assigned implicitly. You need not have to register copyrights explicitly. Okay, this is very, very important. But if you are doing a business, if you are a company and if you are developing a software, in that case, it is better to register a copyright. But with respect to personal use and if there are no monetary gains, then there is no need to actually register your copyright. Okay. So some examples of copyrights include photos, videos, artwork, music, then your software program, databases, designs of a software, for example, database design, etc. Then in case of copyright can or to apply for any work, it must be an original idea or literature that is put to use. The idea alone cannot be protected by a copyright. Say for example, you may have an idea to write a book, but unless you write a book, you will not get the copyright and you will not be protected by copyright. It is the physical use of that idea, such as a design or a written novel, which is covered under copyright law. Copyright also includes for wide range of creativity like intellectual, scientific, artistic form of works, which also includes poems, composition of songs, music, videos, dances, sculptures, software, and many more, specifically vary by concerned authority or jurisdiction. Now, copyright is given to the author according to the law as soon as he completes his work. Say for example, today if you write a research article, the moment you complete your research article, you have got the copyright. It is implicit. But when you publish it in some conference, when you publish it in some journal, usually you sign the copyright transfer form. So in that case, your copyright is transferred to that particular conference or a journal. In order to protect your own work and idea, you need to register the work in the copyright office. But as I have already told you, if there are monetary gains, if there are monetary benefits, then only it's worth to register copyright. Otherwise, it's not required. Many copyright law infringing copies of entertainment files, for example, MP3, music files, VCD video files, etc. And software are often shared by P2P softwares. So P2P softwares are nothing but peer-to-peer softwares. You might have heard of torrent softwares. So whatever softwares you download using torrents, they are all illegal. Okay. So apart from that, there are many people who upload the files on Google Drives and share the link. Even that is illegal. The act of unauthorized uploading of a copyright works for others to download may attract civil or even criminal sanctions. So unauthorized downloading of copyright works entails civil liability. So this is very, very important statement. So if you download a copyrighted work, that is if it is violating the copyrights of others, and if you upload it, then there may be criminal cases filed on you. But if you are downloading, it is only the civil cases can be filed. Then some do's and don'ts here with respect to copyrights. do not copy copyrighted software without author's permission. So if you want to download any software, the best solution I would like to suggest you is search for free and open source softwares. If there are free and open source softwares, directly download it. And note here that you have to also see the licensing there. So what kind of licensing is there? Is it Creative Commons license, or is it standard YouTube license? Is it MIT license? So read the terms and conditions of these licenses and see where they are applicable. So depending on that, you can assign appropriate license to your work, and depending on the license of the software, you may have to request for author's permission. And the major important thing is that even if you ask for a permission, you have to cite and you have to give appropriate credits to the author. Always respect copyright laws and policies. Then computer ethics is a set of moral principles that govern the usage of computers. Then the common issues of computer ethics is violation of copyright issues. Duplicating the copyrighted content without the author's approval, accessing personal information of others are some of the examples that violate ethical principles. Be aware of copyright issues while using online information. Now there is one more important aspect with respect to copyrights. There are many licenses which allows you to embed their content. If you want to embed others' content in your content, then it should be of Creative Commons license version 4.0. Then similarly, whatever material you are using, if it is free and open source, then you cannot earn money or you cannot monetize it. So that's the problem. And if you are using some famous song to create a YouTube video, then when you monetize it, part of earnings will go to the original creators. So that is one solution. Or you may also get copyright strike on your YouTube channel. So if you get copyright strike on your YouTube channel, then you cannot monetize it, and YouTube may even stop monetization facility on your account. So that means it is simply that you will not be able to earn money from your YouTube channel. The next is public computers. Never pass or tell the cyber cafe owner or anyone else in the cyber cafe about your email and password to check your email. Okay, this may sound little bit odd, but the survey is saying that small kids or many old aged persons, that is senior citizens, have no idea about the risks of information theft here. So when you share your details, they will also have access to your inbox. So they will also come to know what kind of emails you get, and they may misuse your email account. Maybe using your email account, they may send some fake mails to somebody else, and that may tarnish your image. So username and passwords always be entered by their owners, and at most you may request for the guidelines to reach login page. So this is very, very important. You just ask them to open your email account page, not any further assistance. If you store or download any personal information on desktop in cyber cafe, make sure you delete all documents after you done with your work. So in your cyber cafe, after your work, delete everything, delete all the files. When I say deleting the files, you should not move those files to recycle bin. You should be deleting even from recycle bin, and clear all the history of the web browser. When surfing the internet, you always should check about the browser security to avoid risks of exposing personal information, such as disabling the option "Remember my ID on this computer," user ID or username also should be secured along with the password to avoid trail passwords by next user. A keylogger is basically a spyware and logs or records your keystrokes so that your username and password are made available to cyber cafe owner or any attacker. So we have just discussed it in our previous slides. So these records may type into directly hacker's machine or collected afterwards through the file transfer. So some of the cyber cafes may use hardware keyloggers also, so that you check that there is an intermediate device between your keyboard and CPU. Now, cyber cafe computers are public computers and shared computers. Your data or communication may be exposed to all users at the same time. So be aware that sensitive information like personal details, like username, passwords should be deleted. Whenever you go to cyber cafe, you ensure that it has most up-to-date antivirus and anti-spam software. These may help to stop some of the keyloggers, trojans and other malware. Don't leave the computer unattended with sensitive information on the screen. For example, you may just open your Facebook dashboard or your email inbox and just walk out of the cyber cafe. In that case, since all these accounts are open, it may be misused at any extent. Up to any extent it can be misused. So better is you have to ensure that you log out. After logging out, clear everything. Because sometimes by mistake you might have clicked option remember these settings on this computer for 30 days. So in that case, that system will not ask you to enter the passwords again. Then don't enter sensitive information into a public computer. Then disable the feature that store passwords. Then force cyber cafe owner to allocate your computer loaded with updated antivirus software. Then finally, always make sure to log out properly when you leave the cyber cafe. Then credit card frauds are most widely known, so you may be aware that on phone hackers get the information about your credit cards and debit cards, even if it is using NFC or even if it is using OTP. Okay, they will use social engineering techniques and they will interact with you and collect all the information from you, and simply they withdraw all the money or they make huge purchases using your cards. So that's why be cautious while using credit cards. Then don't give your credit card PIN number to unknown persons. Avoid sending credit card details through emails. Then don't write PIN number on the credit card. So try to remember it. Now your PIN number should not be the obvious number. For example, your year of birth. Anybody can guess it and just put it as a PIN number. Or last four digits of your mobile number or first four digits of your mobile number. Or your landline phone number, etc. So don't set those things as the PIN numbers of your credit card. And one more important thing which I would like to highlight here is that many times you cannot directly make payments to your credit card. It may have to be attached through PayPal. So these credit card handlers, what they do is they save your settings. Okay. And many times you give the standing instructions. So if you are 100% sure, then only provide the standing instructions, otherwise don't provide or never provide standing instructions. So even if you, in that case, what happens is if you provide standing instruction, even if you stop using the service, you will be charged. So to avoid that, don't provide standing instructions. Once the usage is done, just remove the entry from that account. The next is mobile devices. We know that most of the people nowadays use mobile devices, and we have also seen in the yesterday's webinar that mobile devices are the soft targets for our hackers. And many people, they are not aware of the settings of these mobile devices. So in these couple of slides, I will discuss few guidelines which will help you to use your mobile device securely. Next, be careful while downloading the applications through Bluetooth or MMS attachments. They may contain some harmful software which will affect the mobile phone. So always download the software from the official Play Stores or App Stores. keep the Bluetooth connection in an invisible mode. Unless you need some user to access your mobile phone or laptops, if an unknown user tries to access the mobile phone or laptop through Bluetooth, move away from the coverage area of Bluetooth so that it automatically gets disconnected. So keep turn on your Bluetooth connection. Okay, so once your task is done, just turn off. So whenever there is a need to transfer the files from Bluetooth, just turn on, finish the task, turn off. That's it. Don't keep it always on. Otherwise, if you are in the coverage area of some users and if it is not a secured connection, okay, then they will access all your files from your mobile phone and they may download the sensitive information from your mobile phone to their phones using Bluetooth. Avoid downloading the content into mobile phone or laptop from an untrusted source. Delete the MMS message received from an unknown user without opening it. So you should never open any MMS message if you don't know that person. Sometimes by mistake, even the known person may have or might have sent you the MMS message. So in that case, you can confirm with that person and then open. Read the mobile phone's operating instructions carefully, mainly regarding the security settings, pin code settings, Bluetooth settings, infrared settings, and procedure to download an application. This will help in making your mobile phone secure from malicious programs. Define your own trusted devices that can be connected to the mobile phone or laptop through Bluetooth. That means you can only connect your home devices. Never even connect your friends' devices as trusted devices. Then activate the PIN code request from mobile phone access. Choose a PIN which is unpredictable and which is easy to remember for you. So I have already discussed what should be the safe PIN number. Use the call barring and restriction services provided by operators to prevent the applications that are not used by you or by your family members. Then don't make your mobile phone as a source for your personal data, which is dangerous. If it falls into the hands of strangers, it is advisable not to store important information like credit card and bank cards, passwords, etc. in a mobile phone. Note the IMEI code of your cell phone and keep it in a safe place. This helps the owner to prevent access to the stolen mobile. The operator can block a phone using IMEI code. Then regularly backup important data in the mobile phone or laptop by following the instructions in the manual. Use free cleansing tools which are available in the internet to make your mobile work normally whenever it is affected by malicious software. Again, when I say use free cleansing tools, it should be from the trusted source. Many times these tools are available and these tools are provided by your mobile phone vendor. Then again, with respect to mobile devices, I would like to discuss one more point. That is, whenever you are installing an app, whenever you want to use an app, it asks for certain permissions. So please be careful while providing these permissions. So unnecessarily, it should not ask for permission to access your contact list or a camera. Okay, note here that hackers can take your picture without turning on the flashlight. Okay, you will not even come to know that they have taken your picture. And many times if spywares are installed, then what they can do is they can just transfer all your photographs and information to hacker's machine. So that's why never take the photograph or sensitive information should not be stored in your mobile phone. So don't take even sensitive photos. The next is blogging. So we know that many students write blogs, many people write blogs, even many teachers are writing blogs. So there are some do's and don'ts for blogging. So in case of blogging, never give away your personal information into the blogging sites. So put a reliable information as it reaches entire world and assume what to publish on the web is permanent. Avoid competition with other bloggers, because competition means you are on their target list. State the terms of use, copyright in blog properly to viewers to protect your blogs. Then guide them with other positive examples, such as the children are posting their related information. Post anonymously. This is very, very important. Manage your blog anonymously or adopt an alias for all online posting. This will help protect you in the event that you draw unwanted attention. Then avoid personal or identifying details. Avoid any personal or identifying details when posting in your blog. Do not post in advance about locations that you will be or about areas that you live near. Okay, so similarly, when you are using social media networks, okay, don't post the things like I will be visiting this place, I will be visiting this place on so and so date. So many cyber criminals are on social media. They will see this post, they will read this post, and they will get the information that okay, this person is going out for vacation on these dates, so he will not be available, so we can rob their house. So that is the intention of the criminals on the social media. So don't post the information in advance. That is very, very important. Then no photos. Refrain from posting a picture. Photos can invite trouble or unwanted attention. Then avoid inappropriate dialogue. So be careful not to engage in dialogue that could be interpreted in a way that it was not intended. So sometimes humorous threads can get out of hand. So if the dialogue degrades to an area that makes you uncomfortable, disengage from the dialogue and refrain from further posting. Also, when making decisions about individuals online, consider their past posting behavior and attempt to consider their true intentions. So what comments you write in social media, what article you write in your blog, it is very, very important, and you have to take it seriously and you have to be very, very careful here, because we don't have control on others' minds and we don't know what others think. We don't know how the content will be interpreted by our readers or audience. Okay, so you should be very careful while writing the blogs or while expressing your opinions, even on social media. So you might have heard that Facebook or some other companies, all the social media companies, they are automatically deleting the posts of some people because it is violating their code of conduct. Okay. Always remember that just because you do not have a dialogue with someone does not mean that they are not reading everything that you write. So there are many silent readers. They will not like your post, they will not write any comment, but they will just simply go through what you are doing. They will be simply just observing your activities. So many people merely lurk online and don't engage in comment posting, but do read what is written. So your audience could be much larger than you realize. So let's say, for example, if you are having 2000 followers, maybe at the max 5% or 10% may just interact with that post. But most of the people, 20 to 30% people, they may just read the content. So there are lots of proofs for this. Then timeless. Internet content is timeless, and keep in mind that even if you remove the content, it might be archived or syndicated. Okay. So the moment you put the content, there are many sites which will directly make the copy of it and store it in some other sites. So if you do not want something to be read, do not post it to the internet. Then high schools, colleges, and employers all search the internet to discern an individual's history. So sordid details about a late night will not help land a coveted job. So you should be posting only professional details and design your social media page or timelines or profiles in such a way that it should help your career. So don't post unnecessary things, unnecessary posts, unnecessary jokes, etc. The internet is a haven for all types of predators. So always remember that just because someone says something is true does not mean that it is. So predators adopt personas of who they think you want them to be. So just as we provide guidelines to young children, adults should be wary and take precautions when posting online as well. So for example, we don't know, just because of the name indicates gender, maybe in reality that's not their true gender. Maybe you will find that there is a profile with some girl name, but actually it may not be the girl, it may be the boy. So who is interacting on the girl's name? While blogging can be a great outlet and channel and in some way immortalizing thoughts, it is important that safety is considered and that good blogging practices are followed at all times. Then finally, I have two more links to show. So this is a portal that is cybercrime.gov.in. So if you come across any cyber crimes, you can visit this site and you can report here. So I will just navigate to the website and I will show different features of this website. Yes, this is a website. So it's by Ministry of Home Affairs. So if you come across any cybercrime, then you can directly report it here. So you can see here that this is a portal. This portal is an initiative of Government of India to facilitate victims or complainants to report cybercrime complaints online. So this portal caters to complaints pertaining to cyber crimes only, with special focus on cyber crimes against women and children. So you cannot or you may not be able to report all kinds of cyber crimes. So but you will be able to definitely report cyber crimes against women and children. So complaints reported on this portal are dealt by law enforcement agencies or police based on information available in the complaints. It is imperative to provide correct and accurate details while filling the complaint for prompt action. So please contact local police in case of emergency or for reporting crimes other than cyber crimes. So National Police Helpline number is 100 and National Woman Helpline number is 181. So you can remember these two numbers. In case if you need any help, you can dial 100 or 181. Now here, if we click on the link report woman or child related crimes, so basically there are two options here. Okay, so you can see here the first option is very important, report anonymously. So you need not have to provide your personal details and you can file a complaint anonymously. So if I click on report anonymously, it will open this page and you can click on file complaint. Now you can see here that it displays some conditions. So you have to read the frequently asked questions, so before filing the complaint. Then you have to accept some terms and conditions. That is, it says that the information I have provided on this form is correct. To the best of my knowledge, I acknowledge that providing false information could make me liable to penal actions under the Indian laws. I understand that action on the complaints reported on this portal shall be taken by concerned authorities as per Indian laws. The complaint information you submit to this site is encrypted via secure sockets layer encryption. So please see privacy policy for further information. So then you can click on I accept. Now you can see here there are many fields here. So first one is select the category of complaint. You can see here there are four categories of complaints. First one is child pornography and child sexual abuse material, then rape or gang rape, then publishing or transmitting sexually obscene material in electronic form, then last one is again related to the third one. So you can file only complaints related to these four categories. So if you believe that there is a cybercrime happening which is related to these four categories, then only you have to come here and enter the information. Then you have to provide all the details, for example approximate date and time of incident, receiving or viewing the content, then reasons for delay in reporting, then state or union territories, district, police station, in which area it has happened, where did the incident occur, then any additional information you can provide. Then similarly you have to enter the details of a suspect. Then finally preview your application and submit. So I'm not able to click on the details because I have to complete this form. Then only I will be able to enter the details of a suspect. Then after that you can also report and track your application. So here you have to log in. So citizen login, select state, login ID, mobile number, OTP you will get. So once you enter this form, you will get the, or you will be able to track the information. Then next there is another link, report other cyber crime. So if we click here, again same kind of things are there. So here you have to create an account and submit the other crimes, other cyber crimes. So there are some things like, for example, for Delhi, citizen financial cyber fraud reporting and management system has been activated for prevention of money loss in case of cyber financial fraud. Okay, but this feature is only available for Delhi. The next is, if you are good at cyber security, then you can register as a volunteer. And again, volunteership is not direct. You have to provide KYC. You have to provide all the documents. Then only you will be able to register as a volunteer. So you will be verified. Your ID proof, your address proof will be verified. Then only they will allow you to register as a cyber volunteer. So you can see here, Aadhaar card, Indian passport, voter ID or PAN card or driving license. So these things are required. Residence proof is Indian passport, voter ID, electricity and so on. So these things are required to register as cyber volunteer. The next, if you visit resources section, then there are links like cyber safety tips, cyber awareness. So you visit these links and you will get more information. So for example, this is the cyber safety handbook for adolescents and students on cyber safety. So you can visit this site and go through this document. Then similarly on this site you will find document related to financial frauds. So how financial frauds happen and how you can prevent and how you can be safe in case of financial transactions. Then also there are there's a document here with respect to job frauds. So there are many websites which actually promise the fake jobs and they may ask you to pay some amount of money. Even when you get ads related to jobs on social media, say for example on Facebook or on LinkedIn, you should verify that the ad is coming from the verified source. So Just 2 months back on LinkedIn, I was seeing one advertisement. So it was saying that assistant professor vacancy is there in IIT Kanpur. So, but I had a doubt. How can IIT Kanpur can post ads on LinkedIn? So they don't need to put it. So when I clicked on this link, it was directing me to some college in Bangalore. So it's clearly a fake advertisement. So you have to be aware of, or we have to be aware of such fake advertisements. So in case of that, if you find any information, go to their official sites, go to their career section, see are there any entries. If there are any entries, then you will be able to apply through those sites only, through their official sites only. You need not have to apply through LinkedIn or any other sites. Then similarly, there are matrimonial online frauds. So how you can be cautious in case of matrimonial websites frauds? Again, there is a clear document, so you can just go through it. So all these links, all these documents are available on cybercrime.gov.in, the site which I have just shown you. So it's the same site which you can use for filing the cybercrime complaints. Okay, then similarly, cybersecurity awareness for citizens. So the most recent version is 10th January 2020. Okay, then this is another site, that is www.infosecawareness.in. So whatever content you have seen in my slides, those slides have been, or the content has been extracted from this site. So I have taken the content from only two sections, that is student and a teacher, but there are different guidelines for government employees, for police, for family, for women, for children. And also there are many other sections. I have not covered all the sections. So you can visit this site and click on the appropriate links and you will get more information. And I have extracted just the guidelines from this site, but there is more information available on this site. Okay, even for system or network admins, there are some tips and there are many things. So a lot of things are happening and government is doing a lot of work. Say for example, you can see here, so the workshops conducted for government users are 280 and participants were around 20,000. So similarly, 716 workshops were conducted for academic users and 78,000 people attended. And for even for general users, 43 workshops have been conducted and participants are 10,000 plus. So there are lots of things that are happening here. So you can see here, for example, newsletter is there. You can sign up for a newsletter, right? You can download the different posters or presentations and so on. Then there is a draft syllabus, right? Then there are different contests going on, different activities are going on and so on. Okay. Yeah, this is all about what I wanted to cover and provide some guidelines, some information which can help you to be safe on cyberspace. So if there are any questions, I will be happy to take those questions. So if there are any questions, you can type them in the YouTube. So I will wait for around 2 to 3 minutes. So if there are any questions, you can post it on YouTube or even you can post it in Telegram group. I will wait for another minute. So if I don't get any questions, I will just stop the stream. Yeah, thank you everyone. Thank you everyone for joining this webinar. Now I will hand over the mic to Raghavendra sir.
Good evening everyone. Thank you all for patience hearing, and I thank resource person Gajendra sir for delivering such a good session on cyberspace and how to secure yourself from the hackers and users who intentionally use your information, credential data for their bad purpose. I thank everyone for attending, and I even thank Rajpurit sir for providing such an opportunity to conduct such a web. And I even thank